large, then they tend to be slow. And that is related to the thermal structure. Maybe these cold continents are better stuck to the underlying mantle. Maybe there is a better coupling between the mantle. And that is another argument which is in the classic textbook on plate tectonics. Now, in the modern research, there is a lot more details that people are trying to capture, and the models are much more complicated. Here I just want to give you a feeling of what is going on in the modern modeling. Here are a number of papers which try to make a computer model of what is happening with the South American plate. Okay, so the South American plate is bound by the mid-oceanic ridge on the east side, and on the west side there is the subduction zone. Part of it is a continent and part of it is ocean. Here is a colorful picture showing the same thing. And from geological studies, we also know that the Pacific plate was moving at a different velocity with respect to the South American plate about 10 million years ago. Of course, you can figure that out because we know where the age structure of the Pacific plate is, so we can put it back 10 million years. And then if you can do that, then you can impose on these computer models all the forces that you think are important. So you can put the ridge push, the slab pull force, and so forth, and so forth. And then, just like with the Mantle Convection, you do parameter studies. And this study actually compares the calculated stresses with the measured stresses. So all these little lines that you see here are the principal stresses. The biggest horizontal principal stress. That could be sigma 1 or sigma 3, remember from the stress lecture. And so around South America, there are very well resolvable changes in the stress field, simply because the subduction zone is curved and there are differences in the way that the subduction is going. And then these calculations can be compared with measurements of the stress, which are done in boreholes and so forth. We talked about measurements of the stress in the stress lecture quite some time ago. And if the calculations and the measurements fit with each other, then you can conclude that maybe the assumptions about the driving forces and the boundaries of the plates are more or less the right ones. The problem with these models is that often you don't just have one solution. There are different combinations of parameters that will give you a good fit with the measured parameters. But the main message or the main thing to remember is that modern studies can get us a lot of detail in addition to the classic plate tectonics arguments. But what is very clear from all these modern studies is that the slab pull, remember the plate which is going down, slab pull is the most important plate driving force. Okay, and so now the final part of the lecture is about mantle plumes. Mantle plumes are structures in the mantle where there is a local thermal anomaly, probably at the bottom of the mantle, at the core mantle boundary. And this thermal anomaly rises through the mantle like a diapir, and when it comes close to the surface, it is decompressed, the pressure decreases, it is still quite warm, and it melts, and it produces a lot of magma, basaltic magma, and these can form volcanic islands. And if these plates are moving over these plumes, then you get a chain of oceanic islands. So mantle plumes. So the best example of plumes, linear rising currents in the mantle, is the structure that you see in lava lamps. Maybe some of you have one at home. Here is at the bottom, the material is warm, and it rises in kind of a diapir to the top, and then somewhere else it cools and goes down. And these mantle plumes have been simulated in computer models, which I'm going to show you now. So this model shows you temperature, which is again an anomaly. It is the material which is hotter than the surroundings. From the bottom of the mantle, so this is the core mantle boundary, to the top of the mantle. And what this model shows is the effect of an old slab, which is relatively cold, and it is lying at the bottom of the mantle, kind of shielding the core mantle boundary from an efficient way to lose its heat. And because of that, a lot of heat from the core mantle boundary can be kind of stored at the base of this old plate. And then, after a longer time than usual, you get a very, very large plume. So you can see there is a lot of heat generated here. And when this old slab is heated up enough, then you get a big, big plume that can rise very rapidly and to close to the Earth's surface. So many scientists think that plumes are everywhere, but in fact there is a quite important and active discussion about whether mantle plumes really exist. Direct evidence for mantle plumes would come from results of tomography studies, but these tomography studies are not yet accepted by everybody, and it has not been really convincingly shown that mantle plumes coming from the base of the mantle go all the way to the top of the lithosphere. And there are other explanations than mantle plumes to generate a lot of magma and volcanoes on the top of the lithosphere. So at the moment we have a big discussion in geodynamics about the question whether plumes really exist. There are some very famous scientists who say no, plumes don't exist at all, and I can explain all the phenomena that I see in plate tectonics with just plates moving and mantles, parts of the mantle being more fertile, a little bit hotter than the surroundings, and that way I can also generate a lot of volcanism. And other scientists say no, plumes which really come from the bottom of the mantle and rise to the top are there. There is a very, very good website called mantleplumes.org, and you can find out a lot more details about that if you want. But two things which the mantle plume discussion really must explain is, first of all, the large igneous provinces and the giant swarms of radiating dykes. And I will explain those just very briefly so that you get a little bit of an idea. Large igneous provinces, LIPs, are places on the Earth's surface where in a very short period of time a very, very large amount of basaltic magma has reached the surface. So we are talking about more than 1 billion square kilometer of area. We are talking about more than 1 million cubic kilometer of magma, huge amounts of magma in say, less than 1 million of year. And this is a map of the Earth where large igneous provinces have been associated. And these large igneous provinces are not in a simple way directly connected to plate tectonics processes. Of course, along the mid-oceanic ridges, we also have a very large amount of magmatism, but that is not what I mean. These large igneous provinces, these lips, are the places where huge amount of magma comes to the Earth's surface, not directly related to plate tectonics. A very famous one is the Deccan Traps in India. Another one is, of course, in the Afar Triangle in Africa, and so forth, and so forth. And models which give us plumes or generate these magma in other by other processes must be able to generate these huge amounts of magma in a very, very short amount of time. And associated with these large igneous provinces are what people call the giant dyke swarms. So there are several places where cratons, this is the North American craton, are cut by very large amount of vertical dikes, which sometimes run over 1,000 kilometers. These are enormous dikes. They can be 50 meters in diameter, and you can map them over 1,000 kilometers, and they form these radiating patterns. These giant radiating dyke swarms are thought to be at the basis of these large igneous provinces. This is where the magma actually goes through the brittle crust and makes these radiating fractures. And the top of the radiating dyke swarms is where the large igneous provinces come and cover the Earth's surface. Okay, so what we have seen today is that the structure of the mantle is very complex. We have learned about convection, a process in the fluid which is heated from below, and at a certain critical temperature gradient you will start the convection. We have learned about the Rayleigh number, which gives us the onset of convection. We have seen the arguments why the mantle really must be convecting. And then we have seen some examples of how the mantle could be convecting in the whole mantle, or maybe in a layered fashion. We have seen computer models of mantle convection. We have looked at the boundaries of the plates. We have looked at the plate driving forces. And at the final part of the lecture, we discussed just very briefly this big discussion at the moment about the mantle plumes. And we have seen that a mantle plume is not necessarily a hot spot at the Earth's surface. Thank you.